Cradled in my arms, I held you, and I loved you more with each day passing by. Sharing joy, sharing pain, through the sunshine and the rain. I can't believe it's time to say goodbye. Don't know what the future brings you, but I hope that you'll keep heaven as your goal. For we've taught you how to pray, we made sure you knew the way. So remember my request before you go. When I look around to see if you are standing next to me, just be there. It's not an easy road you're traveling, but every place you go, Jesus has been. And when you find you've made a turn, forgetting what you've learned, you may have to start all over again. Easy road you're bearing, but the trials of your faith will make you strong. Facing dangers unaware, you won't allow what you can't bear. So my prayer is that your faith will bring you home. So see
be standing next to me. Just be there. Cradled in my arms, I held you, and I loved you more with each day passing by. Sharing joy, sharing pain, through the sunshine and the rain. I can't believe it's time to say goodbye. Don't know what the future brings you, but I hope that you'll keep heaven as your goal. For we've taught you how to pray, we made sure you knew the way. So remember my request before. If you are standing next to me, just be there. It's not an easy road you're traveling, but every place you go, Jesus has been. And when you find you've made a turn, forgetting what you've learned, you may have to start all over again. It's not an easy road you're bearing, but the trials of your faith will make you strong. Facing dangers unaware, you won't allow what you can't bear. So my prayer is that your faith will bring you home. Just be there. When I finally make it home and I stand before the throne, just be there. When I look around to see if you are standing next to me. Be standing next to me. Just be there.
One, two, testing. One, two. One, two. One, two. If there's medals for mother, mama, she win every one. One, two. I dreamed mother walked down those heavenly stairs, and medals for mother were given up there. They mentioned a million things mom did for me, and the greatest of all was the one for her love. Medals for mama, for all of the deeds she has done. If there's medals for mother, oh mama, a medal of honor was pinned on her there. A medal of patience and kind loving care. A medal of duty she won up above. But the greatest of all was the one for her love. If there's medals for mama, for all of the deeds she has done. If there's medals for mothers, mama, you win every one. Medals for mother, mama, you win everyone. Mama, you win everyone. Thank you.
Higher than ever.
I've once heard a bird has a broken wings. They can never fly high anymore. Let me tell you what I know. It's not always so, 'cause once I lay broken and so I felt right away. Life wounded brave with no hope of ever flying again. But with grace from above and God's marvelous love, I'm flying higher than I've ever been. will bear. Higher than yesterday's sins, where eagles can soar, I can see heaven's door. I'm flying higher than I've ever been. I fell by the way, life wounded way. Then old Satan, like a vulture, he swept low. My dying soul, as low as life gets, God was not finished yet. He's so more good than I ever saw in me. Now I live above the clouds, so high in the clouds that I can't see the top of the tree. Higher than I ever been, higher than yesterday's sins, where eagles can soar. I can see heaven's low. I'm flying higher than I've ever been. Higher than I ever been. Higher than yesterday's sins. See heaven's glow, I'm flying higher than I've ever been. I'm flying higher than I've ever thank you.
Good morning, church. Brother Sal and me are here to give our tribute to the family, giving our condolences on the departure of Sister Ingah. Our hymn of condolences is The Golden Morning is Fast Approaching.
Hello everyone, this is Nicole Donovan, Nikki as most of you know me, just with a brief tribute for Miss Ingah, or Everyone, this is Nicole Donovan, Nikki, as most of you know me. Just with a brief tribute for Miss Ingah, or Mama, as we all lovingly called her. I knew her all my life. Well, I should say she knew me for my entire life. And what I remember most about her is her love for the young people of the church. I don't think that in all the time that I knew her, I ever heard her raise her voice in anger. I mean, she would tell you, pull you on the side if she saw something, give you a little admonishment, as she would say, about what she saw. And but always, even though there was a word of correction, there was always encouragement. She was always so positive. I remember the days of vacation Bible school. I felt so big when I was able to help fixing the snacks, you know, the Ritz crackers and the peanut butter, or making the Kool-Aid or the tuna sandwiches and so on. You know, you were getting grown when you were able to help with fixing the snacks for vacation Bible school. But she was always so loving and always so positive, and a great example for those of us who follow. The last time I spoke with her was late last year, I think it was, and she was on my mind, so I got her phone number from Brenda, I believe, and I WhatsApp called. Bentley answered the phone, and I told him not to tell her who it was, and it had been about 2.5 years since she'd spoken to me. And it didn't take her 10 seconds before she got my voice. She said, "Nikki," and as soon as she said my name, I burst out in tears. I don't know why. But she was always so caring and loving and kind, and I appreciate that about her, and I will miss her. My condolences to the family members, the members of the church, and we know that if we are faithful, that we will see Mama when Jesus comes again.
Good morning. Thank you. When the waves dark before you and the clouds are hanging low, there is one who watches over you everywhere that you may go. Jesus is the one, yes, he's the only one. Let him have his way until the day is gone. And when he speaks, you'll know the clouds will have to go.
Just want you,
because he loves you. And when you come to cross the river, he will be your friend and guide. You can live with him forever. Over on the other side, Jesus is the one, yes, he's the only one. Let him have his way until the day is gone. And when he speaks, you know the clouds will have to go. Just because he loves you so. Jesus is the one, yes, he's the only one. Let him have his way until the day is gone. And when he speaks, you know the clouds will have to go. Just because he loves you so. Just because he loves you so.
God is my all in all, and God is my light in the darkness. Yes, my God is my all in all. Oh.
Good morning, everyone. On the behalf of the management and staff of David's Funeral Home, I would like to extend my condolences to the Leonard, Callwoods, and Smith families in this your time of loss. At this time, we invite the family members to pay their final respect. Thank you very much.
This was one of Mommy's favorite songs. I have fixed my mind on another time, on another time. And here I mean to stand on till God gives me more light. And that until He comes, I have fixed my mind on another time, on another time. I have set my course on a narrow way. For I know the time is close at hand, for which I watch and pray. And that is today, 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 until He comes. I have set my on the narrow way, on the narrow way. Even so,
sit down a bit, son.
This is my fervent prayer. For I've caught a glimpse.
I was working on by this man, Laura. He told me. front. Down in green pastures. Beside. He restoreth my soul. In the paths. For his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. You may be seated. Today we gather here to celebrate the life of a virtuous, devoted woman of God, Ingah Beatrice Smith. In the midst of sadness, we can have an attitude of gratitude because God gave her 91 years on planet Earth. From a human assessment, I believe Sister Smith has fulfilled God's calling upon her life. And for that, we must give God a high note of praise. Sister Smith was a very active member in this church and also the community of Carrot Bay. Mama, as she was affectionately called, was one of the longest-serving Sabbath school superintendents in the history of the Carrot Bay Seventh-day Adventist Church. She was also known as a veteran in our church's annual harvesting and gathering. Mama believed in kingdom building. She used every single opportunity to let others know about the goodness of God and the honor of serving Jesus. She always reminded persons about being ready for the second coming of Jesus. Mama was compassionate, encouraging, and a very generous lady. Yes, she will be missed because she was granny, mother, aunt, sister, cousin, and friend to many. However, we can hold on to the great memories we shared with her and to the promise that those who die in Christ shall live again. Oh, Day Adventist Church, Carrot Bay, I express my deepest condolences to the family and friends of Ingah Beatrice Smith. Amen.
At this time, we're going to stand and sing our opening hymn. How Cheering is the Christian's Hope. It is the first song that is listed in our booklet. How Cheering is the Christian's Hope while toiling here below. Our Father in heaven, we're just so grateful to be here today in spite of the circumstances. Lord, in spite of all the sadness that is surrounding us right now, Lord, we know that you are here. Your presence is felt. Lord, you have always reminded us that what happens here is just temporary. Death, as we know it, if we live in you, it's only a sleep. So it's only temporary. And Lord, we have the hope that weeping is only going to endure for the evening, but joy comes in the morning. So Lord, today as we celebrate the life of my sister Ingah, we pray, Lord, that you would just be here with us. Comfort those who are in sadness. Lord, draw close to them. Let's keep reminding them, Lord, of her legacy. Who she was, what she did for all of us. And we know that we have the hope that we will indeed see her again.
Yes.
So, Lord, as we celebrate her life this morning, we pray that you would just be with us in everything that is done, everything that is said. And, Lord, may your name be glorified today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
You go, Jesus has been, and when you find you've made a turn, forgetting what you've learned, you may have to start all over again. It's not an easy road you're bearing, but the trials of your faith will make you strong. Facing dangers unaware, you won't allow what you can't bear. So my prayer is that your faith will bring you home. So just be there.
Listen, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed.
In a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed.
For the perishable must clothe themselves, and with the imperishable and the mortal with immortality.
When the perishable has been clothed with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality, then the saying is written will come true. Death has been swallowed up in victory.
Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting?
The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. Here ends the scripture reading.
this time we're going to favor with a special selection from the Advent Lights.
Brightly be our Father's mercy from the light,
struggling, see. trim your feet, lamps, my brother. Some poor sailor, tempest tossed, trying now to make the harbor in the darkness may be lost. So let your lower lights be burning. Send your gleam across the way. Some poor faint and struggling seaman, you may rescue, you may save. So let your lower lights be burning. Send your gleam across the way. Some poor faint and struggling seaman, you may rescue, you may save. You may rescue, you may save.
Our second passage of scripture is taken from 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 to 18. Brothers and sisters, we do not want you to be uninformed about those who sleep in death, so that you do not grieve like the rest of mankind who have no hope. For we believe that Jesus died and rose again, and so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. According to the Lord's word, we tell you that we who are still alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep.
For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel and with the trumpet of call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive are left will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet him. Amen. And the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words.
Ingah Beatrice Leonard Smith, affectionately known as Ma, Mama, Miss Ingah, and Sister Ingah was born on September 6, 1930 in Carrot Bay on Tortola in the beautiful British Virgin Islands. She was the first of six children born from the union of the late Abraham Leonard. Anton Leonard, Malcolm Leonard, and Christine Leonard Smith. Mama grew up in Carrot Bay, and she attended the West End Methodist School, the only formal school on the northwestern end of the island at that time. At times, she reminisced of the olden days when young people had more chores to do in the mornings before walking from Carrot Bay to West End to attend school. Their chores included caring for the animals, bringing water from the well, and going up the hillside to take breakfast to their fathers who were farming. Life was hard, but good. And they learned to be disciplined, respectful, honest, trustworthy, and spiritual. Mama explained to us that upon completing the 7th standard grade, only a few students were able to go on to attend high school in Rotung. To do so, suitable housing accommodations in Rotung had to be provided. Most of the other students found local jobs, while others sought employment in the USVI or further abroad. She worked and lived in St. Thomas for a short while, but returned to Tortola. And on October 15, 1953, she married Angel Smith, the love of her life and her spiritual leader. They were married for 67 years. Until his death on December 31st, 2020. Mama always insisted that he died on January 1st, 2021 because the Bible states that a new day begins at sunset and not at midnight. She believed in education and encouraged her children to study and read widely. I can attest to this, especially spiritual books. I remember when we used to come up on summers and all of us just wanted to be watching TV. Those of you who remember, you remember, why don't just go up and pick up a book to read? And then that's when we would go to the sea by Sugar Mill. But anyway. She believed in education and encouraged her children to study and read widely, especially spiritual books. She sent all her children to the Seventh-day Adventist School in Carrot Bay, where the school started. She was an avid reader, and she could always find numerous books displayed in her home. She had an excellent memory, especially in her later years. After she lost her vision in 2015, her memory sharpened and her hearing became heightened. She knew many texts from the Bible, hymns, and even the hymn numbers. These remained intact in her memory until the end. Before taking any medication, Mama would ask how the medication looked, what it was for, when it should be given, and how it should be given, because she said that no one was going to overdose her. She remembered that when the payroll was due for the workers that were taking care of her and Grandpa, she knew how much they were due and even how many days they worked or were absent. She had a great memory. In the 1980s, she decided to go back to school to finish her secondary education. She attended night school in Rotung and completed her GED. She even took and passed 2 CXC exams. This was admirable for a lady in her 50s as she was studying with mostly teenage students. Around that time, she completed her Master Guide program and became a certified youth leader. She was encouraged to continue her education at the H. Laverty Stull Community College. However, this was not meant to be because her eyesight began to fail. Mama was a very health-conscious person. Apart from her vision loss, she always received a good bill of health. She never liked her family snacking between meals and or drinking beverages while eating. She became a vegetarian in the 1970s and in the 1970s. If she drank anything with her meals, it had to have been 1 hour before or 1 hour after her meal. She also did not like to eat anything after 6 p.m. Mama worked at home full-time raising her 8 children, yet she was still incredibly involved in her church and community. She was a substitute teacher on many occasions at the SDS school when it was in Carrot Bay. When a teacher had duties to do in Rotung and needing coverage with classes, they called on her. Mama accepted the Advent message and was baptized in the late 1940s, and she served her church well. She was one of the longest serving summer school superintendents. She also served as Dorcas or the community service, as a community services leader, deaconess, summer school teacher, Advent Youth or MV sponsor, assistant treasurer, assistant pathfinder director, pathfinder counselor, and in the personal ministries department. She was a champion in gatherer in the church's annual harvest in gathering campaign. She understood what it meant to sow the seeds for the gathering of souls for God's kingdom. Although she lost her vision, she never lost her mission. Her contributors were so devoted to her that even if she didn't make the request, many would still send or deliver their contributions to her, even up to this year. Even though she collected over $3,500 each year, it was never about the money, but about people being saved in God's kingdom. She began her work as a literature evangelist in the 1970s and became an admired literature evangelist, or Carl Porter, who did not let the loss of her vision prevent her from introducing the Advent message to others through her ministry. Whenever persons visited her home, she would take the opportunity to promote and sell her books. No one, absolutely no one, left her home without her talking to them about God. The conversation always ended with her encouraging the individual to stay faithful to God and be ready for his second coming. She continued both her evangelistic endeavors until her death. In recent years, she attended the literature evangelist trainings with her eldest daughter, Yulene, Mommy, via Zoom. These trainings were held by Pastor Henry Peters, who is a publishing director of the North Caribbean Conference of Seventh-day Adventists, and by the Caribbean Union. The publishing director of the Caribbean Union Conference, Sister Hyacinth Smith, spoke one-on-one with Mama at the end of one of the trainings. She congratulated her for her many years in the Carl Porter ministry and her creativity in this evangelistic work. Mama strongly believed in these three statements from Ellen White's book, Carl Porter Ministry. This is from page 4. It says, "There are many places in which the voice of the minister cannot be heard. Places that can only be reached through the public, through publications, the books, papers, tracts filled with the Bible that people need." From page 20, it says, "God calls for workers from every church among us to enter the service as canvasser evangelists." And page 21, "Let every believer scatter broadcast tracts and leaflets and books containing the message for this time." Mama fulfilled her mission until the end. I can attest to this as well. That was the one person where whenever I call, it was maybe about 30 seconds and then we start talking about end time prophecies. That was one thing about Mama. She did not just speak words meaninglessly. She believed every word that she spoke. Her love for travel took her all over the Caribbean on church-related travel, personal trips, and family cruises. She even visited Montserrat after the volcano eruption. In travels further afield, she was able to see places and things she read about and sung about as a child, such as the White Cliffs of Dover, a landmark chalk white coastline on the southern eastern tip of England. She marveled as she witnessed the changing of the guards at the Buckingham Palace in England, admired the Belgium countryside, stood at the base of the Eiffel Tower in France, toured a cheese factory in Holland, peered through the observatory windows of the CN Tower in Toronto, Canada, examined Maya ruins in Mexico, and toured the Green Alcalado factory in Curacao. These are just some of the many wonderful places she visited. Despite all that she saw, she said, "Nothing will compare with heaven." Because God said, "Eyes have not seen nor ear heard, nor have entered into the heart of man, which God has prepared for those who love him." Mama was honest, humble, and trustworthy. She said, "If you do not have anything good to say about someone, then do not say anything at all. I guess that's why sometimes I'm quiet. She reminded us to stay away from gossiping and reminded us of Proverbs 21:23. Those who guard their mouths and their tongues keep themselves from calamity. She loved her family and always taught us right from wrong. She told us phrases like, do not say things you cannot make right. Do not hang your hat higher than you can reach it. Not every pan that knock you should go. Good manners carry you through the world. And my favorite, put God first in everything you do. Those phrases were simple but profound. In those lessons that her children, grandchildren, and any young person that she encountered learned, Mama was a praying person, a praying woman, and she prayed daily for her family, her siblings, the sick and the shut-in. She especially prayed daily for her children and their spouses and all her grandchildren and their spouses and her great-grandchildren, calling each one by name. What a task. I remember I didn't appreciate it younger, because sometimes, you know, it's early in the morning, Grandpa would wake us up and say it's time for worship, 5 o'clock in the morning. And then they would just be having these long prayers. And you know, the funny thing about it is I find myself praying the same way. She did it without reservation. Even through her brief illness, this was done. She was a notable woman, a notable example of a Christian woman, a stalwart in Christian education, youth ministry, personal and publishing ministries. On May 30th, 2022, 1 year, 5 months after the sunshine of her life, Andrea passed away, she went to rest. She fought a good fight. She finished her course and she kept the faith. God will truly say, thou good, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Her desire was always that when the Lord asks her, Ingah, where is the flock that I have given you? She will be able to say, here they are, Lord. Let us keep faithful and be present for that heavenly roll call.
In just a few minutes, we will be giving a message of hope by Pastor Trent Berg. But prior to that, we'll be hearing from a group affectionately called Mama's Choir.
Those of you who, everybody knows Mommy. Mommy loved music. So if you're hearing a lot of music this morning, this is our tribute to her. Because Mommy not just loved music, but she loved good music. Because anytime you sing and you don't sound good, she will tell you about it. You will say, Lord, you get us some of the juice. So we are hoping that this tribute today will not give us some of the juice. But we hope that you appreciate music the way she appreciated every song, and take the words to heart, because the song is on cloudy day, and we're looking forward to that day when we see Mommy. And these are all these up here, these are her babies, true and true time, but no has Mommy, Mama, Ma, but she know all of them, and from time she hear each one of their voices, she go call their name. All right? Mm-hmm.
me Abba home, so far away. Oh, they tell me Abba home, where I will be going. Oh, they tell me.
Oh, they tell me.
Yes, they tell me. Oh, tell me of a land.
one too.
To feel like we're having church up in here.
Amen.
That's how it ought to be. It seems as if our funerals are becoming our reunions. And we really should work to keep them separate. But when you come together to mark the life of someone who took God at his word. You see, for most of us, we have to determine whether God is telling the truth or he's lying. And Sister Smith determined that God was telling the truth. Pardon a second.
Excuse me, the driver of PW1214, you're blocking a driveway. It's a small silver car. It's a Honda. PW1214, you're blocking a driveway.
It's always a pleasure to be able to come here to Carrot Bay. It's remarkable that it's over 20 years since I was with you as pastor. But time flies when you're having fun. And it was my intention when we gathered together at the occasion of Brother Andrew's funeral, to have at least connected some dots in the minds of some that was not clearly known to me when I was your pastor years ago. And maybe perhaps God hid it so that it would not interfere with my service to the church. But my paternal grandmother was born in Seacow's Bay, and her certificate secured at the Methodist Church Manse, it indicates Albion's Seacow's Bay. And it had been a long time that I tried to secure from my father an understanding of who his family was or is here in Tortola. All he knew is that his mom was sent by her mother as a little girl to St. Thomas to be raised by her aunt. And she took him in the 1950s to Rowtown, and he said he met his family and that family had an inn. We asked many people, but many could not recall until one day, about the year 2001, that upon entering for a Pathfinder event someone overheard my conversation with another. And then the gentleman who heard us said, "I know who your family is." I said, "Who is?" He says, "They are the ones who used to run the old Wayside Inn." And so those persons who are Scatcliffes and Francis's, and as we spread out from there, the Leonards and the Callwoods, my grandmother was a Francis. And the Stouts, and we've expanded that understanding as we have been able to talk with so many. But it's wonderful to know that if we weren't certain about the blood here, we are certain about the blood of Jesus Christ indeed. That's the blood that really counts. It's the one that we need to be applied to our account today. And so in that spirit, as I speak with you today, it is true that the loss of a mother brings us to a place where we're confronted with our emotions. We feel almost as if we're wrestling with an unseen enemy that seems to want to control how we view our experience today. But one thing is certain. God has a word that points us beyond the present and reminds us that He will have the last say. And so I invite you to join with me as we look heavenward on such an auspicious occasion. I read for you from the Gospel of John, chapter 5. And it says, "Marvel not at this, for the hour is coming, in the which all that are in the graves shall hear his voice, and shall come forth, they that have done good unto the resurrection of life, and they that have done evil unto the resurrection of damnation." Today I want to speak to you on the subject, "Don't worry, I'll fix it." Don't worry, I'll fix it. Let us pray. "And now, Father, I ask that you make me just a nail hanging upon a wall, and upon a thing so common and yet so small, hang a bright and lovely picture of your face, that every weary traveler of life may look and see your glory and your grace. O Lord, let none think of me, but only let me be just that nail hanging a bright and lovely picture of your face in its place. And may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be found acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and our Redeemer. Amen." I'm sure you've heard of Kyron McMaster. You've heard of him, right? You've heard of Chantel Malone, is that right? Yes, these celebrated BVI athletes that have put our territory on the map around the world. We're proud of them, and so many others who seek to distinguish themselves when they have the opportunity to travel. But I'm certain you haven't heard about Julia. Julia Hawkins is her name. You see, Julia in February of 2019 and entered the U.S. National Track and Field events in Albuquerque, New Mexico. And she won. What did she win? She won the 50-meter and 100-meter races at the good old age of 103. That's right. She took up running at 101. And she has been running ever since. People are so excited to see this lady going down the track at an amazing age, at a rather slow speed, yet still outrunning all of her opponents who were all lined up with her that were in the 100-year plus class. And they came up with a fitting name. They called her Hurricane Hawkins. I like that. But I want you to know, friends of mine, it doesn't matter how much you exercise. It doesn't matter how many vitamins you take. All of us are going to die. Unless the Lord intervenes, as he has promised. But the Bible is very clear, and somehow people just don't seem to believe it. But it says in Ecclesiastes chapter 9, verses 5 and 6, that the living know that they shall die, but the dead know not anything. Their love, their hatred, their envy is now perished. Nevermore will they have a share in anything under the sun. So all of us have an appointment with death. Recently, in a phone conversation with a retiree, I asked him how he was doing. He responded by saying that he was in the waiting room. Immediately, I thought that he was at the airport. Sensing my confusion, he explained. What he meant was that all of us are in the waiting room. Some will wait longer than others. The problem is, you know what the problem is. The problem is, we don't know our time. And so here we are, brought together as family and friends and coworkers and church family members, all brought together here in a moment where we're confronted with the reality that what has happened tomorrow can happen to us. And the reality is we have to determine what we're going to do about it. Job chapter 14 verses 1 to 2 says, a man that is born of a woman is a few days, and full of trouble. It could be car trouble, financial trouble, relationship trouble, but it's trouble all right. He comes forth like a flower and fades away, and to every grieving heart today. With that reality being established, it's important that you know that even though you've received the news that Sister Ingah had passed, and that in that moment you found yourself wrestling with emotions. Somehow you find your eyes filled with tears. Maybe it is this moment where the reality that the coffin is now closed and there is no nothing but a sense of finality that God wants to say to you in this moment, don't worry. I'll fix it. grip of grief. He's holding you tightly. And nothing you have tried to do, when someone starts to feel grief, it comes like waves. The problem is you can't see the wave coming. There's some people, they just keep busy. They just keep busy. Ma, what you doing? I'm just keeping busy. Because I know a wave is coming. A wave of grief is coming. I'm keeping busy. God wants us to be assured. He's going to fix it. Amen. This world is created by a loving God. And from his hand came a world that had no traces of imperfection. Our foreparents, Adam and Eve, however, listened to the serpent's suggestion to distrust God's word and to trust the serpent. And in that same mixed-up situation came now the entrance of sin and lawlessness in the world. We now have a generation of people who think they are smarter than God. Could you imagine that? They already think they're smarter than their parents because they have Google. They think Google knows everything. Really? Well, who put Google there? But it's so true. The Bible establishes a fundamental truth. The soul that sinneth, the person who sins, will die. And so what does the world need? What the world needs, doctors don't prescribe it. What the world needs, nurses don't administer it. What the world needs, pharmacists don't carry it. For what the world needs is Jesus. What the world needs, One Mart doesn't stock it. What the world needs, Home Depot doesn't sell it. What the world needs, even Amazon doesn't have it. For what the world needs is Jesus. What the world needs, AstraZeneca doesn't make it. What the world needs, Pfizer doesn't produce it. What the world needs, the United States doesn't manufacture it. Yes. For what the world needs is Jesus. Amen. And so the Bible says, you shall call his name Jesus. Why? For he shall save his people. From what? From their sins. That's the good news. And so that's the reason why God could say to Inga, don't worry. I'm going to fix it. How is God going to fix it? First of all, he has to fix the heavens. Why he has to fix the heavens? Because where man has gone, sin has gone. Man has gone to the moon, sin has gone to the moon. And so the Bible says, our God shall come and shall not keep silent. A tempestuous fire will be ablaze round about him. And as he comes, he will purify the heavens. Oh, thank God that he will cleanse it. But not just the heavens, he's going to fix the earth. A recent news report indicated, issued by the U.S. Coast Guard, that there was a damaged platform, oil platform, in the Gulf. The initial report that was issued by the persons consulted was that this broken platform was sitting above 26 different wells, and they were told that it was only a leak, just a slight leak, that was the equivalent of 1 gallon per day. The court accepted the testimony, even though it was required that there be a cleanup fund set aside by the company in the equivalent of $320+ million. But someone got curious and went back to look more carefully, only to discover that well that they said had been producing just 1 gallon per day, spilling that into the Gulf of Mexico, was actually spilling 1,000 gallons a day. Friends of mine, the world is messed up. You know, we heard that the birds had flu, the cows had foot and mouth disease, men had cancer, diabetes, post-traumatic stress, sickle cell anemia, lupus, and we could go on and on and on. This world is messed up, and God is hoping that somehow we'll come to the conclusion that we need to have a fix. Even Corona has come along, and now you have Corona 19, Corona 20, Corona 21, and now we're hearing about Corona 22 in twin forms. This world is messed up. We watched on television. I remember seeing on CNN, seeing the folk in Japan walking through the airport with their masks on and never imagined it would happen to us. Now here we are. If you don't wear your mask, somebody might be upset with you. We found ourselves separated, all finding our corners, hoping to find refuge from this unseen enemy. Our leaders were struggling to figure out what to do. But the wisdom is not with men. The wisdom has always been with God.
Yes.
God knows what to do with Corona.
Mm-hmm.
And the Bible is clear. If any man lack wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives all men liberally. So we got a world that's messed up. And God has to fix the earth. And I want you to know that you don't have to just fix the earth. You don't have to just fix the heavens. He has to fix the devil too. Could you imagine what it would be like when the devil's case comes to heaven's court? His rap sheet is so long, they'll be reading for ages and ages to come. You know, he may have showed up at your house. And how do I know? Because he showed up at mine. And he may have interfered today with your desire to be comforted by hearing the voice of your mother, your grandmother, your auntie, your great-grandmother, whoever she may be to you. I want you to understand that he shows up and he causes a lot of trouble. In fact, in St. Thomas, they were so worried about him that someone came up with a song, say, "Look, the devil day." Some mothers get a little worried when the kids start acting up and then they want to call their children the devil too. Say, "The devil gotten you today." Isn't it amazing that in the time that Sister Ingah was coming up, that parents didn't have cell phones, but they always knew what you were up to? And we have cell phones, we still don't know what they're doing. You got to hire a company to put a check on the phone so you can go on the computer check to see what. And today, you know, we have all these devices, but we could hardly remember anything. You hear people saying, "Child, my head ain't good, you know. We don't memorize nothing no more." There was a time when we used to know every number, every phone number by heart. What's so-and-so number? Oh, so. Now we got all kind of devices. We lost our memory.
True.
We got faster cars, faster devices, computers on our desk at work. All the data in your handheld, and we have less time to do what we got to do. This world is messed up. Now we still wanted to wait for the latest iPhone to come out. The world is messed up. And Sister Inga understood that. That's why she settled herself in the Word of God. Because she realized that God was going to always balance her out. It didn't matter where the currents flowed. That ship of Zion that she climbed onto when she was a young lady, she climbed onto it and she strapped herself in. And what did she strap it in? With the Word of God. Now today you have to explain to people that an epistle is not the wife of the apostle. We have become biblically illiterate. One young man was heard in Sunday school saying, he said, the teacher was trying to teach them a lesson, you know, because they weren't coming on time. And she was talking about all these big words, sanctification and glorification and then she wanted to introduce him another one, you know, procrastination. And the little boy shot up his hand and she said, "What, Sonny?" She said, "Teacher, I really don't know what it means, you know, but my church believes in it." Yes, some of them will get that a little later tonight. You hear a shout, you know, you see a shout somewhere. But we are procrastinating to do the Lord's work. That's why we're still here. Sister Inga understood she didn't want to stay here. She didn't want to wait until it got really bad. So she took opportunities when they came. You came to a house, you're going to hear about Jesus. You came to a house, she's going to remind you, time is short. Jesus is coming again. That was on the lips of every Advent believer. But we stopped talking about it. When more so than ever before. It is so true. He is coming. Can't stay anymore. In fact, you got to be out here. It was recently reported that they found a mass of trash in the Pacific Ocean the size of Texas. It's on YouTube. You can watch and see for yourself. You know how big Texas is? I've driven through Texas. Took us a whole day. But that's what we're talking about. God has to fix it. And his plan says, I got to take my children out of the earth, and then I got to clean it up. And then I promise them, I'll give you a new heaven and a new earth. But this one is going to be different because in it will dwell righteousness. God is asking us to put our confidence not in politics or in politicians. They will let us down. Songwriter is so true. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest phrase, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. Why? On Christ, the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. So this world is messed up. I'm so glad he's going to fix the devil. You know how he's going to fix the devil? He's going to set him on fire. Ezekiel chapter 28 tells us that. He's going to set a fire, but the fire is going to start from the inside. He's so rotten, he's going to burn him from the inside out. You know, the fireman said, if you're on fire, what do you do? You stop, drop, and roll. Isn't that right? Well, he won't be able to stop, nor drop, nor roll. Going to burn him out. And then he's going to allow his ashes to remain on the earth. And the Bible says we'll have the privilege to see his ashes. And we will say, is this the one who made the nations tremble? I'm so glad that God has a rescue plan. He has a rescue plan. If you want to get there, I'm so glad you don't have to take a PCR test. It's already prayed for. With the precious blood of Jesus. You just got to claim it. Just waiting for you. Just waiting for you. Oh, I'm so glad today. I want you to know he's going to fix the heavens. I want you to know he's going to fix the earth. I want you to know he's going to fix the devil. But you know what's most important? He has to fix you and me. You know, follow me. Man would change his car. He would change his hair color. He'd change his citizenship. He'd change his residence. Hello? Yeah. He'd change his doctor. He'd change his diet. He'd change his job. He'd change his clothes. He'd change the oil on his car. He would change his spouse. But he cannot change himself. So that's why I tell people, I'm so glad when I met Jesus. Because when I met Jesus, I want you to know I started saving money. Jesus has a savings plan. Follow me now. You see, when I met Jesus, I saved my cigarette money. Hello. You see, when I met Jesus, I saved my ganja money. Hello. When I met Jesus, I saved my prostitute money.
Come on now.
Hello. When I met Jesus, I saved my lottery money. Amen. Hello. All those things that I'm tempted to spend my money on, when I met Jesus, it made a difference in my life. Amen. Because I recognized I couldn't change myself. But in order to get to glory and to dwell with holy beings, something got to change. And if I changed, families will change. And if families change, churches will change. And if churches will change, communities will change. And if communities will change, a BVI will change. Yeah. Amazing to me that we've come to a place where somebody loses their life on this earth, in our community, and nobody seems to be offended. When God's child was gunned down. God's child was gunned down. And nobody seems outraged. Nobody in the BVI seems to be troubled. But I thank God he has the power. And so I made sure I went to him on bended knee. Found a quiet spot and called on Jesus. Pleaded for his amazing grace. And I'm glad to know that I don't have to wait for a letter to come to inform me when it's going to come in the mail. I don't have to wait for an email to inform me that E-Zone is sending it my way. It is instantaneous. as the words that I speak from my lips. I'm so glad that grace doesn't take days to come. It comes immediately. Oh, and I have a big brother. And there came a point in time where I had to inherit his clothes. I didn't like that. I wanted clothes for me. But in those days, you just kept your mouth shut. As you might see, you may just see something just flash before your face. And next thing you know, your mouth is going that way. That was a time before they figure out that the old time discipline was child abuse. Pew. And so, you know, they call it hand me down. It sounds belittling, hand me down. And so I had to go and put on my hand me down. And my mother tried to cheer me up. She said, "Son, don't worry, I'm going to take it in." You know those days? Come on now, somebody knows what I'm talking about. You know, you got to take it in. You take it in. Now some of us eating filet mignon or whatever they call it. And now we need to let it out. Can't take it in no more. You got to let it out, you know. We're spreading out. But I realized that when God wants to give me my robe of righteousness one day, God don't have to take it in or let it out. It's going to come my size. It's going to come with my name on it. There's a new name in glory, and it's mine. Why? Because I believe, like Ingah, that if I call on Jesus, if I confess my sins, I ain't got no time studying my neighbor. Ain't got no time. When Ingah said, "Don't talk about people," he said, "You need to focus on your backyard." Focus on your backyard. Clean up your backyard. Lord, it is me standing in the need of prayer. Not my mother, not my brother, not my sister. It's me, oh Lord. She believed if we confess our sins, we're still faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Yes, this doesn't sound like a funeral sermon, because it isn't, because she's secure. She's secure. She made her calling and election sure. She decided she wasn't going to wait up until the last morning. Let me tell you something. One time I was going to St. Croix, and I went down to the seaplane and got my ticket. I had been checking the wind speeds. And when I got around and we were called, I realized there were only three of us going out to the plane. And that should have told me something. You know, but I'm just a little slow upstairs, you know. I got on the plane, we strapped in, you know. And then the pilot took us out, and next thing you know, the plane is going down Crown Bay. I'm like, he never went that way before. And then as we got down Crown Bay, we turned around, and then I heard the engine. I said, never sounded that loud before. And as the plane started to take off, and the plane started to go up, the plane went up like on one angle. And then all of a sudden, the plane started to go down. And I said, Lord, is there something we need to talk about? And the plane went, and it went back up. I said, praise God, we're going back up. And we fought a while, And it dipped and danced a little while. Let me tell you something. Ingah believed that it was important to meet with Jesus every morning at 5 o'clock. That's where she secured her life in Christ. She didn't leave it up to a luck and chance. She didn't leave it up to the rolling of a dice. She believed that if you want to serve the Lord, you ought to be wholehearted in it. So if you want to accuse her of something, you would accuse her of believing God like a child, implicitly, his word. But some of us, we big now. and we think we're smarter than God. Well, I thank God he's going to fix the heavens. He's going to fix the earth. He's going to fix all devil. But I thank God he fixed me. And I just want to plead with you today. Plead with you. Put your affections on things above. The news report said in the Telegraph that a frantic woman had come in asking for a news story to be written. What had happened? Her daughter had been harassing her over and over again, telling her, please, mommy, you need to get rid of that old bed. She said, man, you know what you're talking about. I love my bed. Leave my bed alone. But the daughter just wouldn't have it. And finally, after all of the cajoling and the pleading, the daughter came up with an idea. Mommy's birthday is coming up, and she's going to surprise her mama. What she was going to do? She was going to slip that old lumpy mattress out and slip a brand new pasta beanie in. That night, when mama came back home, she was too tired to determine what had happened. But that morning, that next morning, what a shriek came from the bedroom. But the daughter was prepared. She rushed in to tell her mother, mommy, I don't worry. I already fixed it. I have you had a brand new mattress. Look, feel it, mommy. And the mother's looking horrified, and the face is not changing, despite what she's saying. And then she decides, you know, I better listen to my mother. Mommy, what's the problem? Only to discover that her mother had the most expensive mattress in the country of Israel. She later explained to her daughter that the reason why she didn't want to change out the mattress is because for years she had been putting her life savings inside the mattress, and it was approximately, this is a real story, friends, approximately $1 million was tucked away in that mattress. And so here they were, pleading for help to see if someone could help them to determine which of the three large dumps in the country the mattress was delivered to. As far as I have detected, there's never been a report that that mattress has ever been seen again. Friends of mine, some of us treat our homes like that. Some of us treat our relationships like that. But the Bible says that we ought to lay up our treasure in heaven, where moth and rust doth not corrupt, where thieves cannot break through and steal. I dare tell you, if someone broke into your house, that if you put all your money inside of your Bible and put it on the shelf, they'll never find it. Nobody wants the Word of God, but the Word of God was there in the hands of Sister Ingah, and she put the Word of God in her heart. So much so she could recite the Word from her mind. And so she set her compass heavenward. And oh, I pray today, in the shadow of her coffin, as you stand there, I call heaven to witness that I've warned you this day of trouble to come. Jesus is coming. And God is saying, as the old saints are laid aside, it's time to put aside these things of earth that have occupied our mind and fix our eyes on Jesus. Fix it. Fix your gaze. Someone says, turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face. And the things of this earth, insurance bill, the stress on the job, dealing with the children, helping your daughter with her grandchildren, with your grandchildren, whatever the stress of life, it will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace. I want you to know, Jesus says, don't worry, I'll fix it.
We certainly want to thank the Lord for using Pastor Berg in such a mighty way, reminding us not to worry, but that God will fix it. Let us bow our heads as we pray. Dear Heavenly Father and our God, our King of Kings and Lord of Lords, the one we can call on and you will answer. The one who sits on the throne even when we are going through difficult times. The one who is our refuge, our fortress, a mighty deliverer, the conquering lion of the tribe of Judah. We give you praise, dear God, because there's absolutely no God like you. Father, dear God, we just want to thank you for the opportunity where we can talk to you. Because we know that you're God who always listens, no matter what the situation is. And we want to thank you, dear God, for that reminder that we are not to worry, because you are the God who fixes every situation. In a special way, dear God, I present to you the family of Sister Ingah Beatrice Smith. Father, we know that losing a loved one is never an easy thing. Words can't describe the emotional pain. But we are so thankful that we have a high priest who understands the feelings of our infirmities. We are so thankful that we have a God who said, using the psalmist David, that God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in the time of trouble. I pray that you be with this family in a special way. And Father, dear God, even though they don't have their mom anymore, they have the great memories, the good morals and values she would have instilled in them, the scriptures that she would have taught them to learn and to fall in love with, and of course, falling in love with Jesus, the man who will never leave them nor forsake them. Father, may they understand that now is the time to draw closer to each other. I pray in a special way that you'll put a hedge of protection around them so that no weapon formed against them shall be able to prosper. May you bind the Smith's family with cords of love that can never ever be broken. And Father, even though things may seem tough and rough, help them to know that as long as they are anchored in Jesus, that they shall be able to sail through the storms of life. Father God, I pray for every person here today that they will recognize that the funeral service is not for the dead. It's for the living, Lord. For the living to ensure that their lives is in the hands of the Almighty. Father, the Apostle Paul reminds us that we are to work out our own salvation with fear and trembling. Father, when we look at our world today, it's not only the elderly that are dying, but young, dear God, are dying as well. And I pray that all of us today will use this as an opportunity to accept the Lord as our personal Lord and Savior. Father, dear God, may you cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And may you give us a fresh outpouring of your Holy Spirit so that we can live lives that will truly represent you. Father, we thank you for your word. Your word will never fail us. And it's Isaiah 48 that reminds us that the grass withereth, the flowers fadeth, but the word of our God shall stand forever. Father God, if we want to see Sister Ingah again, it means we need to make sure that our lives is in the hands of the Almighty. So when that day should come, and the trump shall sound, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. We also who are alive will be changed and will be able to see our loved ones just like Sister Ingah once again. What a day, what a family reunion that will be when we can all see King Jesus and sing and shout the victory. Continue to comfort us all, dear God, and help us to be hopeful. Help us to be prayerful. Help us to be faithful. And help us not to worry, because you've promised that you will fix it. Continue to bless us and have your way, O Lord. In Jesus' precious name I pray. Amen. At this time, we will stand. At this time, there will be a musical selection. And then after, we'll have a recessional hymn, hymn number 542, Waiting and Watching. Okay, so at this time, we will go straight to a recessional hymn, hymn number 542, Waiting and Watching. Let us stand as we give God the praise in the midst of our situation. Don't worry, God will fix it.